in this house. You know, thank you guys for just ushering us into the presence of God. And you know, you belong to a great house. I just want to let you know that. I've had the privilege of going around to many churches and growing up in a being a PK, pastor's kid. You know, my dad ministers in a lot of places, and I've come to appreciate our house and being able to worship with each and every one of you, and even just, you know, how you guys really desire to enter into the presence of God. So it's such a privilege to be a part today. Tell the person beside you, I'm glad you're here today.
I'm glad you're here today.
All right, I know it's a long weekend season, so many of the faces that you maybe are used to seeing are probably somewhere else, that you're seeing pictures instead because they're away, maybe just getting in some other vacation. But, you know, it's great to be in the presence and in the house of God this afternoon. Amen?
Amen.
And just to update you, my parents, Pastor Jerry and Pastor Alvy, of course, they are in the Philippines, and they told me to bring you greetings. So they're thinking about you. They're saying, you know, how's the church? Every time we FaceTime, it's FaceTime, or we message them, they always are sure to ask me. They're thinking about you, saying, how's everybody in Scarborough? How's everybody there? So they're really praying for you and thinking about you. But at the same time, they're doing such a great work over in the Philippines. Of course, it might feel like a long time that they're gone, but they have a lot to do in a short amount of time. And they've been doing so many things in terms of working with the church there. And Pastor BJ, it's such a praise report, and many of you have seen on Facebook that Pastor BJ was really connected to the Champion Life family. And so we're just praising God because we have somebody else in our family to, you know, he's been already working there, so it's not, and he knows many of you here in this family, so it's just a privilege that we get to be able to continue on to work with him even for in the Philippines. And so my parents have been telling me that him and his wife have been doing such a great work in the Philippines, so continue to pray for them, and even Pastor BJ especially, and his wife, and the church in the Philippines, as they continue to sow their lives into there to make an impact. And also for my parents, for the remaining weeks that they're there, continue to pray for their health, because, you know, my dad and my mom, they're go-getters. You know, many of the times when you hear where they're going, it's always here and then there. And then if they meet with you, then they have a meeting afterwards with somebody else. So they just have such a burden and a heart for the kingdom. And so continue to keep them in your prayers, because they're doing all these leadership things, even conferences here and there. So they're not on vacation for sure. They're working hard. But we're just so thankful to them because it's their heart for the kingdom. So I know that as this afternoon, I've been privileged to be able to be with you here today. We had a great service in Brampton with Pastor Roy this morning. So I get to be here in Scarborough, and just talking about, I know my dad has done almost like a series of change. He talked about the journey to change. And this was actually one of the sermons that, or preachings, or messages that I also preached alongside with that sermon series. So I talked to him about it, and he said, you know, maybe it would be a great idea for us to continue and just end off maybe that series, because I know he started a different one, just do it about the boat, you know, and a lot of things. But I believe that we're always in changes, especially in Scarborough and here. God wants to do great things in our life, and that always involves change. Amen? And so, just like in our lives, you know how we always come, and every year, most of the time, every year, we think about change. You know, the beginning of the year, it's a new year, new season, we think about all the changes we want to make. And I believe that every part of our lives, that God continues, it's not just at the beginning of the year, but God continuously wants to bring change in our lives. He's a God that moves from glory to glory. Amen? So there's things and seasons we've been through, and God wants to bring even more change. So tell the person beside you, it's time to change. And you've been looking at some of the, I remember my dad talked about, if you weren't here with us, he really talked about Mary being highly favored and how God brought change through her, and also Jabez, and enlarging your capacity and how God wants to enlarge your capacity. And so when I think about change, and many of you can probably relate to this person if you've been in the church family or, you know, for quite a while now, or even if it's your first time, there's a person in the Bible that when you think about change, it's almost like one of the main guys. And this guy is none other than Paul or Saul. So we're going to look at the Bible today, and I know it's a familiar passage, but I want us all to read it. His road to Damascus was literally his journey to change. It was literally his road to change. And so we're going to open our Bibles into Acts 9, 1 to 28. So it's quite a longer passage today. So I'm going to get your help to read it, if we can have it up on the screen. What we'll do is you will read the first two verses, and then I will read another two verses, and then you'll read another two. Is that all right? So we can participate this afternoon. All right, so you will begin. So we're going to turn to Acts 9, 1 to 2. So go ahead. 1, 2, ready, read.
Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went into the high priest and asked him for the priestly synagogue in Damascus, so that he could be found out in him who was talking to him, and a man or woman, and to take him his business to Jerusalem.
All right. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. And all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem.
He has come from the authority from the chief priests to arrest all who call upon me. But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go, this man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and the kings and before the people of Israel.
I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it, placing his hands on Saul. He said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." The disciples in Damascus, I went earlier. At once, he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. All those who heard him were astonished and asked, "Isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on his name? And hasn't he come here to take them as prisoners to the chief priests?" Yet Saul grew. Kept close watch on the city gates in order to kill him. But his followers took him by night and lowered him in a basket through an opening wall. When he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple.
But when Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles,
He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord, and the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with him and moved on.
All right, long one, but let's pray. Father God, we just thank you for your word, and we just thank you that this afternoon, God, you want to speak to us. So, God, I just pray, Lord, for every heart and every mind to just be open towards your move, towards what you want to say, towards the fresh manna that, Lord, you are giving to us. God, I pray that every heart would just be just like a true disciple, Lord, a learner of you, eager and anticipating, Lord, what you want to speak into each and every one of our lives. So, God, I pray and I thank you that, Holy Spirit, you would do your unique work inside each and every person this afternoon. May you alone be the one that's glorified and the one that's seen. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so everybody, many of you have probably heard this story before, read this story, many preachings about this story. So it might not be a new passage to you, but just a recap for those of you, I know we read a lot of things. So there was Saul, who is also Paul, was persecuting Christians at the time. He was wanting to imprison them. On his way to Damascus, a light from heaven came, and then he fell to the ground. Then he encountered God, and God really spoke to him. He told him to go to a city where he would receive more instruction. And then he was blind, and he couldn't eat for about 3 days. So he then went to the city, and meanwhile, God spoke to another man who was named Ananias, and about Saul. And so Ananias met Saul, spoke to him, and then laid his hands on him. And so the Bible says that suddenly scales fell from his eyes, and he could see again. Then he was baptized, and he began preaching that Jesus was the Son of God, and he was instantly changed. So on Paul's road to change, we can learn about our own road to change. Many of the times we've been thinking about change, like I said earlier in the year, when it's New Year time, we start thinking about all the things we want to change in our lives, what God wants to do, but God consistently wants to bring change in our lives. And we can learn from what Paul is or Saul has been through on his road to change. We can learn about our own road to change, that we desire to change and become more like Christ. So the first thing of understanding, if we want change in our lives, we need to understand, number one, the difference of change. So in Acts 9:20-22, you'll see in the verse that Saul became, there was a difference to his change. So if you see in verses 20-22, he was the one that they're saying, isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on his name? And hasn't he come here to take prisoners? So when we're talking about change, it's important to understand the nature of change. According to the definition in the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, change means to become different, to make or someone or something different, to become something else. So from Paul's example in those verses, we can see that when we describe Paul's change, he became different. So there was a difference to his change. If you look at verse 20, the Bible says that people were astonished that the man who was once persecuting the believers of Jesus was now the one preaching that Jesus was the Son of God. He was completely different. Paul went from a persecutor to a preacher. Friends, change means a transformation. It means something is different, or in other words, not the same. I know the word metamorpho, which describes transformation, or the root words of to be transformed, comes from metamorpho, which literally means to metamorphose. Like it comes from the metamorphosis, you know, the same word metamorpho, to change, to transfigure, to transform. The Bible talks about this when they were talking about the transfiguration, right? And also when the Bible talked about Romans 12:2, that we ought to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, or even in 2 Corinthians, we'll go there later, 3:18-19, that how we are transformed into the image of Christ. So this transformation and this change that we speak of is, we must know, if we desire a change in our lives, we must know what change actually looks like in our own lives, what it means for ourselves. It means that things will not look the same. It may sound very obvious to you, many of you, oh, of course, Michelle, change means it's different. But really, many of us don't realize that change means that in our lives, the things that we're going through, who we are, will be different. Let's consider a caterpillar, and you can just put up that picture. I don't know if you have it up there. But if you consider a caterpillar to a butterfly, the same process that we describe metamorphosis, that's what they use to describe the transformation of a caterpillar to a butterfly. It's when something transforms or changes and it becomes completely different. You see, the caterpillar looks completely different to a butterfly. Friends, that's what change looks like. Just like the Bible says how we change when we receive Jesus, we become a new creation. We're never the same again. So let's look at 2 Corinthians 5:17. The Bible says, therefore, if anyone belongs to Christ, there begins a new creation. The old things have gone. Everything is made new. And in your own life, friends, I want to talk to you that change means things are becoming new in your life. It means things are becoming different. It's when things in your life are no longer the same. The old things, the old way, the old pattern, the old habits are gone. Let's consider some examples maybe that you can relate to in your own life. For example, if you are a worried person, if you are a worrier, then it looks different when you change. You're no longer worried. So a worrisome person, when they change, or a stressed person, becomes the most peaceful person. Maybe change looks like when a sick person becomes healthy. It's completely different. When a fearful person becomes adventurous. When a stingy person becomes generous. When a poor person becomes rich. When a grouchy person becomes joyful. You see, friends, that's the nature of change in our lives. When something completely transforms our life, that we no longer look the same. That's a personal testimony given in my life. I'm sure in many of your lives, when you receive Jesus in your life, there's certain things in your life that no longer look the same. Maybe you were somebody who was always constantly cursing or speaking negative things. And when Jesus grabbed a hold of your life, you were now praying and releasing blessing. It looked completely different. In my own life, if you know my testimony, many of you will not believe that I used to be many things that I'm not today because God changed me. I know a lot of people would never believe that I was quiet. And that's many of your testimony with speaking. It's always completely different. Many of you would not believe that I was the KJ, the killjoy. When I was a kid, I would always be the one grumpy, like, You know, my parents had to drag me. They're like, Michelle, and I'm always stomping my feet. Everybody in Brampton, when I remember talking about this, they were all laughing because all the older ones who saw me growing up, they said, you're right. You know, whenever I'd come to your house and, you know, Michelle was always the one, you know, who's always grumpy about life. You know, whenever my parents wanted to do something, I was the one who's like, no, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. And now it's so hard to believe. Because God has just taken my life from somebody who's been grumpy and you know, maybe fearful or quiet. And He's taken me on a journey and He has changed my life so I look completely different. That I'm probably one of the ones who is always smiling and joyful. So it's hard to believe that at one point I was the KJ. Because now I'm the game, right? Let's do it. Alright, and I'm sure that many of you, that's your testimony. But we need to, just like Paul, that's his testimony. Saul to Paul, that even the people, the Bible says that people were amazed. They astonished because Paul or Saul was the one who was persecuted. He was the one who agreed to Stephen stoning. He was the one threatening to kill Christians. And then he completely changed to become the one who's preaching about Jesus. That's in our day, that's almost equivalent to grabbing somebody who's almost an ISIS terrorist and becoming the next Billy Graham, just having mass crusades. That's what change looks like. Somebody completely different. And God wants to do real change in our lives. And it's not just one-time thing. I think that's what we need to realize as Christians, is that God wants to continuously bring change into our lives. And that means that areas in our lives, He wants to make different. That's so different that people will never believe that that was you before. We must recognize that in our lives, that things should not remain the same. So, friends, let me ask you some questions. What things in your life are still the same? You know, we may be celebrating here and saying, yes, God, you changed me from here to here. But what things? I want you to ask yourself. I want the Holy Spirit to begin to illuminate in your heart and your mind. What are the things still the same? Because maybe the big things, maybe, yes, I'm like this now. God really changed me, but there's still more that God wants to do. He wants to make a difference in your life. For example, if you look at your life from last year to this year, what things are still the same? Do you still have the same attitude? Do you still get offended very easily? Are you still maybe living as a victim to life? Or in fear? Are you still very worried? Are you still, you know, having unforgiveness in your heart towards someone? Is there bitterness in your heart for some reason? Are you still living in fear or anxiety? Are you still hoarding things and maybe living a very fearful life? That's why you're not able to be generous. Are you still living where you're defeated all the time? Friends, it's time to ask God to bring change in our lives. But what is the difference? Not just desire to have everything the same. But in order for us to experience God's change in our lives, there's also, not only is there a difference to change, but we must realize that there's an obedience to change. Let's look at Acts 9, 6. We're looking at our passage today. The Bible says, now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do. This was God speaking to Paul after he was encountered for Saul. In order for us to experience the change we want in our lives, we must be obedient to what God says. For us to see Him move and work and His power to flow, we need to begin to align ourselves to what He said, His direction, His leading. You see, on Paul's road or Saul's road to Damascus, God had a plan of change for his life, but he had to obey. God told him, for him to be able to encounter Ananias, receive his sight back, and get along with his life to be used by God, he had to follow the instructions that God gave him. See, when he encountered, you remember that passage, when he encountered God and God spoke and gave him very specific instructions, said, go to the city, you'll receive instructions. Consider this, imagine if he did not obey. Imagine if he said, you know, maybe not today, maybe another time, or maybe I'll put it off until, you know, until maybe I feel more comfortable, maybe the road, maybe it's raining today, you know, or maybe it's just not the perfect timing for me to obey you, Lord. So maybe I'll put it off. What if he put it off? What if he didn't obey the Lord? What if he then, of course, he would have remained blind. He would have not met Ananias. And in the same way, friends, in our lives, God is giving us direct instructions. Paul had to obey, or Saul had to obey God's word instructions for him to experience the change that God already had planned in his life. And in the same way, we need to obey. Think about your life and the change that God has been putting on your heart. Maybe there's things in your life that God has already spoken into and said, this, I want this to change. And you know, your heart has been softened, and maybe you've come here listening to a sermon or a preaching, and you really wanted to receive that word. You wanted to see the manifestation of that word in your life. But really, on the other end of that change was actually obedience. Was you to begin to see God's purpose in your life and to experience His plan that of change for your life was actually obedience. Maybe there's a new thing that God wants to do, and He's given you promises. You know, maybe to prosper you and to, but He's told you to change. Maybe you've received the prophetic word or specific instruction about something, and maybe have been avoiding it or putting it off. See, friends, in order for us to see the change and God's plan for us, we need to obey. There's an obedience to our change. Just like when you look at Saul, God gave the instruction. He gave the word. But there was an obedience that he had to follow those specific instructions in his life so that he could encounter, he could receive his healing. Maybe in your life, maybe God has healing. Maybe God has promotion. Maybe God has blessing. Maybe God has joy. Maybe God has peace on the other side, but there's an obedience that He requires. It means following His instruction. He can speak. Maybe He might not, it might not look like us falling down and you know, God just speaking to us audibly, but He's speaking through His word. Every Sunday, maybe in our life groups, you know, maybe even in our quiet time with the Lord, as we're reading the Bible, the Holy Spirit speaks to us. God is speaking to us and giving us instructions on things that He wants to work out in our lives. So we can't just hear the word, but of course we need to follow it. You remember James 1:25, the Bible says, "But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does." There's areas in our lives that God is bringing instruction, even convicting us and telling us to do certain things, maybe regarding our lifestyle, maybe regarding our habits, regarding our finances, how we handle our money, our maturity, how we treat other people, how we speak to them, our bosses, our coworkers, our family. Even maybe bringing conviction in our personal devotion and the way, you know, Pastor Roy talked about intimacy the other week in Brampton, and maybe it's requiring, God's requiring an intimacy with you. He's speaking of devotion or worship, and He's speaking to your life to bring change in your life, or regarding your direction or calling, where God wants you to go, a position. And maybe you're one of the people who wants to see the big change. You have a heart, you say, God, I want to see the change. Maybe how many countless altar calls you've been saying, God, I want the change. You know, you've been, oh God, I want it. But we need to realize that it's more than just receiving it, but it's also applying, receiving God's instruction and following it. So imagine if Paul just heard, yes, God, I want to see. Saul is saying, God, I want to see. But then never followed the instructions. What would happen? He would still be blind. Maybe that's like us today. We need to have faith, and for us to receive the healing, for us to receive the promotion, we need to obey God's word. Just to give you an illustration, if you know about having a trainer or working out, for example, maybe if it's about losing weight or getting fit or trying to put to gain some more muscles. And for example, maybe you want to hire a trainer to help you. Maybe even if the trainer will have a specific plan, they'll have specific instructions. Okay, you got to do this. Maybe you need to eat this. And then maybe you need to do this. And then it will grow. So it's not just the same thing. They continuously coach you through the different stages of how your body needs to react and how the different exercises you need to do. But if you never would want to follow it, nothing will happen, for sure. So even if the trainer would say, okay, do this many squats, then this many push-ups, or do this much weight, and you said, never mind, then nothing will change, right? And many of us look at God and we kind of look at him and say, hey God, I want to change, but I don't want to follow. That's too hard. You know, that's too many squats. That's too many. How about can you decrease it? But then we want the change. See, many of us treat it that way where we say, God, I want this, but can you make the requirement part easier? But he's giving you the prescription. He's giving you the instruction of what exactly you need to do to bring change in your life, to see that change. Well, it's our response if we're going to follow. If we want to receive breakthrough in our lives in all these areas, we need to align ourselves to God's word and obey his instructions, just like Saul did. The reality is we can struggle and try to do things our own way, but if we don't obey, we won't see the power of God and his purpose prevail. Look at in Proverbs 19:21, many are the plans in a person's heart, but it's the Lord's purpose that prevails. We need to obey. Tell the person beside you, it's time to obey. So not only is there a difference to change or a required obedience, difference in change, there's not only a required obedience to change, but lastly, there's also a purpose for change. Let's look at Acts 9:15-16. But the Lord said to Ananias, go, this man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. You see, friends, God has a purpose for your change. Not only we're looking at change, there's not only a difference and it's there's not only a required obedience, but you might be saying, why? Why should I change if it's too hard? Because God has a purpose for your change. Look at Saul's life. There was things that he faced, but God already in the Bible said, he is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles. God had a purpose for the change that he were to encounter. When we read the scripture, that's why God wanted to change Saul's life. Because there was people on the other end. There was things on the other end. There was a purpose for the change. God wanted, desired that Paul would be used as his instrument to show the Gentiles that they could receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior. After Saul or Paul encountered Jesus and obeyed him, there was much purpose for his life. As you already know, he was used so powerfully to write, even, you know, scripture says that he began to preach that Jesus was the Messiah right away. So right away, God already, there was such a purpose that immediately God, he was already beginning to preach about Jesus. That's how much purpose there was in who he was, and that's why God wanted to change him. We also know that he ventured on 3 missionary journeys throughout the Roman Empire. He was the one planting churches, preaching the gospel, giving strength and encouragement to the early Christians in the church at that time. In fact, a significant portion of what you know of the Bible was written by Paul. Out of 27 books of the New Testament, Paul is credited as being the author of 13 of them. You know, some of the Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, I won't name all of them, but there's 13. And in the same way, friend, God has a purpose for your change. God has a purpose for your life. God wants to use you as his instrument. What if, on the other side of your change, you were the one who God chose to write the books of the Bible in the day? Imagine. So I can only imagine that Paul probably didn't know that that's what God had intended for his change. That much of what the impact of Christianity and how we know Jesus today is because of his life. In the same way, many times we don't know that God actually has such a purpose for our lives. Who knows? Down the road, who will be saying, I'm there because of this person. Because of the change that God did in their life. Jesus said that we would even do greater works than him, and God is calling us to expand his kingdom and be about his Father's business. God has given you different talents, given you abilities, and wants you to use them to glorify him. But he wants to bring us to a place of change in our lives, that we can be a witness for him, just like Paul. See, God completely changed his life. He was completely different. And as a result, everything that already God built in his life became a tool and a vessel for him to be used by God. And there's certain things in your life that God wants to use, but he's asking us to change, so that we could be like him, to reflect him and represent him to others. So Romans 8, 28 to 29. And we know that God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. For those who he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brethren. 2 Corinthians 3:18, and we all who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. God has a purpose for our change. There's a reason he wants to bring change in our life. A reason why he wants you to be set free from bondage. There's a reason why he wants you to be free from sin. There's a reason why he wants you to come from being a place of maybe, you know, being unlovable to being super loved, to being loving. There's a reason why he wants your relationship to be restored. There's a reason why he wants you to grow up, to mature. There's a reason why he wants your attitude to change. Because he wants you to conform you to the image of him. There's a purpose that God wants to use us to represent and reflect him. So in your lives, what still looks like you, God wants to change it to be like him. He wants to bring real change in your life, so that, you know, even in my life, remember I was talking about, I used to be super grumpy. And now I can see that God brought change in my life to be able to encourage. I look at my life and say, imagine if I was still in the same place. There's many young people that relate to me through the grace of God. They relate to me, and I'm able to encourage them and to love them and to walk with them and continue to push them forward into their destiny for God. And I look at my life, and if I had been on the same place, I would not be able to be used by God for those people. God had a purpose to take me out of my grumpiness, take me out of my miserable, my caginess. Even that, he had a purpose to bring, that I would look completely different, because this looks like him, that doesn't look like him. And there's things in our lives that don't look like Jesus. And the Bible says that the change in our lives is so that we become conformed to the image of Christ. But there's a purpose for the change in our life. He wants us to be a witness for him, just like Paul. Where we bring change, because of our transformation, God can use us in our gifts, in the abilities that, you know, even other people would be astonished. You know, I love hearing people's testimonies, because I sometimes can't believe it. You're like, oh man, you used to be that. Thank the Lord. Thank you, Jesus, that you change people. Right? That's how God moves. And we must recognize. So God, friends, God wants to bring real change in our lives. Who wants change in their lives? You know, I believe that it's not just a New Year thing, but the Bible says an ever-increasing glory. So that means there's ever-increasing change. The moment we realize that, the moment we will stop sitting and being content with the change that happened when we received Christ. And we'll be contending for more of the change to become like Christ. Amen. God wants to do that work in our life. There's areas, maybe it's a little thing. You know, maybe it's our attitude. Or maybe it's the way we get. Or maybe it's, you know, we're going like this to this. You know, or maybe it's a serious thing. Maybe there's bondage, you know, that, or maybe things be the way we see, and God wants to show us something different. The way we see people, maybe the way we see our church, maybe we see the way we see family. God wants to break through in those areas, because there's a nation, there's people, there's There's God wants to bring change in this nation, and it starts by Him bringing change in our lives. But in order for that to happen, we must recognize that change means it will be different. There's a difference to your change. We're going one thing, so it's not going to look the same. Let's ask God, what looks the same? What looks the same in my life? God, what things need to look like you? That's how we're going to ask for change. And secondly, remember, I'm just recapping. We need to continue to ask God to move us from being one thing to looking like Him. And we must also recognize, in order for that change to happen, for it to go completely different, just like Saul to Paul, persecutor to preacher, maybe frothy to joyful, peace, no, anxiety to peace, peaceful. Maybe stingy to generous. In order for us to move from that, there's a required obedience to change. There's an obedience for us to change. We must be willing to see God's instruction, His whisper in our lives. We cannot delay it. We have to obey. We have to hear His voice and say, God, is this you? Is there instruction that I'm not following in my devotional time? If it's spending more time, maybe you heard it so many times, spend time with the Lord, spend time with the Lord for your life group leaders, or you know, even other people, spend time with the Lord, and yet you're still not spending time with the Lord, means you're not obeying His instruction. I'm just being very real, because I know that's probably a hard point for our Christian lives, because everything's grabbing our attention. But God wants to move in that area. We need to, you know, maybe it's giving your tithes. Maybe it's something like that. Maybe it's spending more time with people. And it's really God speaking and wants to bring change. Or maybe if you desire to see people healed, maybe the required obedience is you pray for that person. You have enough faith to pray for them if you want to see somebody get healed. There's a required obedience, just like Paul. He went the moment God said, go to the sea. He went because he obeyed, and on the other end was he recognized that there was always a purpose for his change. In the same way in our lives, in order for us to experience God's purpose, His plan and will for our lives, we must recognize that, you know, the reason why is because God has a purpose. God has a purpose to make Him like Him, so that people will know Him and get to understand Him, and we will be a witness, and God can use our gifts and our talents and who we are to further His kingdom. Our breakthrough, that blessing, that joy, that peace might be on the other side of our obedience. God wants to use us as an instrument to expand His kingdom, to do His work, and to be about His Father's business, to represent Him and to be a witness of His power. So I'm going to call a worship team. And, you know, this is something that I know it's a very, again, simple message about change. And about many of you have heard this story and understood Paul. Know that that's what happened, that the scales fell off of his eyes. But friends, it's not really about what you know today, but it's really about what God wants to do in your heart and your life. That's what it's about today. That's the opportunity that God gives us, His mercy, His grace. There's areas, if we look back, and you look back in your life, maybe it's just yesterday. Maybe it's a couple of months, a couple of weeks, or even maybe if you look back over the year, you see what things God has said the same that you want to work through. God, I know you want to bring change, but God, give me the grace to be obedient. What's the instruction that you want to give me? What are the things? God, give me the faith and show me that this is not just because for any other reason, but because I want to be like you. I want to know you. I want to be used for your glory. I want others to know who you are in my life. So we're going to stand and we're going to sing this song. If we can sing the Give Me Faith. to just, you know, I believe that there's just a power in this house that, you know, all of us can just begin to stand and we're just going to worship God. And we're going to pray, we're going to ask God to search our hearts. We're going to search our hearts and ask God, Holy Spirit, reveal to us those things. We need you, Jesus, because we want to be like you. Every area of our lives, from the little things to the big things, God, bring change in this place. So we'll sing this song, and then after that, I'll come back up, and then I'll invite people, you know, we're going to pray for you, or L5, and are here today. We'll pray with you. I'll pray with you as well. To just believe God for the change that you're believing for. Amen. So we'll sing this, and if you already want to come up, you can feel free to come up.